Let me tell you about this, is every year, all law enforcement agencies across the country, including Alaska and Hawaii, they send numbers to the FBI. It's called, they come up with an annual report. It's called FBI Uniform Report with the annual. They come up with this. It's online. I don't have the numbers with me right now, but I can tell you this, is that the Navajo Nation numbers is really, really high. Major crime is in the Yota. If you look at the numbers, it is really, really, really outrageous. To the point of, if you compare us to other communities, if you compare us to other tribes within the country, honestly, it is really high. If you compare us per capita wise to other either municipalities, urban areas, it is really high. The Neni Tlini, as he mentioned just a while ago, okay, what do we do here? Is get back to the basics. I was just thinking about my own Ali Tsohana and Hasin Tane. We had an upbringing. And I tell my kids this, is that during the summer times, it was really, really short for us because we only had 3 months to play at home. The Bebane, Kashibane, Kadobe, Kashibane, and I tell my kids, this is, man, I had a ball. It was fun. We didn't have any TV, no radio, no nothing, but we had a good time at home because we were so busy and very, very occupied. We didn't have time to do nothing. We didn't have time to do drive-bys or whatever, drink, smoke marijuana. My own. Let's get back to what we were brought up with the Navajo. One case I want to tell you is when I graduated from the Navajo Police Academy way back when, 1982, I was a young rookie. During the class, one of the instructors said that maybe one of these days you guys can make a mark in the U.S. Judicial system, meaning that you may have a case in the U.S. Supreme Court. Just no, so always remember that, and sure enough, it did. One of the highest cases, one of the cases I did, made it to the Ninth Circuit Court. And it is a domestic violence case that originated from North Winslow in Delcon and Loop area. There was a lady that apparently was a victim of Opie's kind of all over the hill. She was near death when they found her. And when I went to interview her in Winslow at the Indian Health Services, and she didn't say nothing. And I took some pictures of her, and I did the investigation. And they found the guy who did this, and apparently he was intoxicated, of course. A lot of the cases that we do involving domestic violence is caused by people being intoxicated. Now, whenever that happens, whenever there's a sexual assault that happens, whatever happens, because people are too drunk, they can't remember anything that happened. But a lot of times you're going by physical evidence. Sometimes that's all you have. So in this case, it was like that. And this lady was on life support for approximately 2 weeks on the mountain. When she finally told me what happened, who did this, we were able to make a federal arrest. That went to the federal court. The reason it was appealed to the next level was because the judge, the federal judge, apparently brought his instructions wrong to both, especially the defendant when he was being sentenced, even in that was appealed. A call that was going through the process called as a result. A they came back together. They got back together as boyfriend and girlfriend. The victim said, I don't want to be involved with this no more. So that's where it ended. But the numbers I'm telling you about that is going to the FBI uniform crime reporting is really high. A lot of these numbers are domestic violence numbers. It's very unfortunate. I tell the people that I'm not proud of this, but I think that we as people can turn this around. And we're trying so hard to do this. We're collaborating resources with the Navajo Nation Judicial, with the Chief Justice, with the Navajo Nation Attorney General, and ourselves by having a strategy and trying to change this around. But like he said in his presentation, you can only do so much with enforcement. But the power is in us. I'm here as moms and dads and grandpas. The power is within the home. So I just wanted to share that with you very briefly. One other thing I want to tell you about, the New Mexico U.S. Attorney's Office is really, really engaged. The FBI from over the hill in Albuquerque and in Farmington and Gallup, they're engaged every day. They do media releases of all the cases that they arrest, make an arrest. If there's an indictment, if there's a sentencing, I'll tell you that it's me, and I get it every day on my phone. And you sort of get a sense of what's going on in Crown Point, what's going on in Shiprock, what's going on in Elm, what's going on in Tuajime, and all the news releases that they make, I think the majority is Navajo cases. Very unfortunate. But I need because that's saying, what do we do? How do we combat this? The Kohane on the screen just a while ago, he said, let's stand against them. Let's stand up for ourselves. Let's stand up for our kids. It's really unfortunate. It's very surprising to me having a young lady standing before us, you know, talking about the symptoms of suicide, talking about the symptoms of desperation, of being, but it's good to see that she recovered. She's normal, and she's speaking with a very, very clear voice, and she has a clear message to as well, to all of us. So, just want to let you know that this is probably the only chapter that I've been at the most. Thank you very much.